Ian Hendry, the nominal star of Assassin, was the nearly great star of British cinema in the 1960s. He died in 1984, aged just 53, catching broadcasters and media a bit on the hop because he died on Christmas Eve. The press didn't seem to know how to cover his passing. Nevertheless, his death was announced on the BBC and ITN and reported extensively in the tabloids, though a lot of the facts were not accurate. Back in 2012, I had written his biography, Send in the Clowns. I wanted to find out why an actor who had given such great performances in films such as Live Now, Pay Later and The Hill had failed to become an international star. Hendry certainly had all the prerequisites to become a world star. He had aggression, energy, vitality, a masculine presence, and an extraordinary ability to create a character within a few seconds. Above all, it was his timing that was absolutely flawless. Watch his first scenes with James Coburn in a film from 1974 called The Internecine Project, if you doubt me.
Tapes? It's impossible. Never said anything to anyone.
What's the matter with you? Are you sick?
No, I just don't feel very well.
After training at the Central School where Judi Dench, in the year just below him, had recalled him as a born actor, Hendry had started on TV in Police Surgeon, the forerunner of The Avengers, and the first series of The Avengers itself, of which he was the nominal star along with Patrick McNee. Along the way, he also gave some remarkable performances in armchair theatre presentations. Catch especially Afternoon of an Imp in 1962, as a cynical TV director forced to make chocolate commercials while waiting for his big break. In that production, he met his future wife, actress Janet Munro, who played a young starlet, and hold that name, because their fates would be similar, and perhaps their tempestuous relationship would give us a clue as to why Ian never became the world star that he should have done. Nevertheless, things progressed well for Ian in movies at the beginning. After he left The Avengers, Ian believed it was bad for an actor to stay in the same role. He starred in several homegrown British realist or kitchen sink films of the early 1960s, most notably Live Now, Pay Later, as a fast-talking door-to-door salesman who dallies with the ladies or the beauty jungle, and This Is My Street, before gravitating to villainous roles in films like The Hill and The Southern Star. In Roman Polanski's Repulsion, he showed how subtle he could be, playing the boyfriend of Yvonne Furneaux. He was never flamboyant, not looking to steal scenes off other players, just totally truthful to the script. Another performer might have been tempted to do more of a star turn, but he just supports the other players beautifully. Watch how his character suggests, ever so delicately, that the Catherine Deneuve character is in fact mad. It's all done with little looks and even a fluttering of his eyelashes as she recoils from his playful advances. Not flamboyant, just totally truthful. You couldn't imagine Hendry's fellow Hellraisers giving such a low-key performance. Sidney Lumet's The Hill in 1965 was, I think, Ian's finest work in movies. A very clever performance as a sadistic sergeant who forces his men to run up and down the hill in sweltering heat in a World War II North African military prison. Watch it again and you'll see that Ian steals the acting honors. The character he plays is a coward who can't face real action, so he compensates by over-egging the martinet role. It's a painful film to sit through. Man's inhumanity to man and all that, and that is perhaps testament to Hendry's skill. Ian played another bad guy opposite Orson Welles, Ursula Andress and George Segal in The Southern Star from 1968. But by then, Ian seemed happier playing bad guys. And one of the first programs I remember seeing Ian Hendry in was Vendetta for the Saint, as a mafia boss, sadistically stubbing his cigar out on Amy McDonald's hand.
Don't ever do anything stupid. Don't even think about it, because if you do, and I do throw you out, you will be unemployable in every sense of the word. You understand?
But Templar made me take it. I was going to give it back to you.
You're a good and obedient girl. I have a little surprise for you.
Was there perhaps something slightly furtive about Ian that meant he wasn't destined to play the hero after all? Fact is, Ian played heavies very well. Same in Get Carter in 1970, filmed just a couple of years before Assassin. Ian played Eric Pace, another cowardly villain, and gives an aggressive, angry turn, perhaps fueled in part by artistic envy that the role he coveted and was initially considered for. The role of Carter itself had been taken by Michael Caine. It's another riveting, very menacing and sinister, but ultimately cowardly and crass and no match for Carter. By 1970, however, Hendry's career as a leading man in movies was already starting to wane. A reputation for heavy drinking dogged him. He and Janet had lived the life of Riley throughout most of the 1960s, living on the Thames on an island in Shepperton. There were great parties, some attended by Burton and Taylor, and even Jimi Hendrix had allegedly swum in their pool. The booze flowed and so did the currants. There was one time when Janet was almost killed in an accident. On another occasion, Ian accidentally reversed his Bentley into the Thames. So by 1970, Hendry was regressing to supporting roles, albeit some top ones in excellent movies. TV kept him busy. Series like The Informer as a disbarred barrister, the sci-fi comedy The Adventures of Don Quick, and above all my favourite series of his, The Lotus Eaters, in which he played an expat on the island of Crete. This for me sealed his reputation as one of Britain's finest television actors.
Ah, good morning. Nice day to be up and about.
By the way, Wanda Ventham played his wife. She was later mother to an actor named Benedict Cumberbatch. Whatever happened to him, I don't know. The key to Hendry's success was that thought seemed to filter through the screen. Think it through and it will show, was always Ian's advice to younger actors. And how true that was. He pioneered a laid-back, very naturalistic style of acting. It's strange to look back at The Lotus Eaters. Ian's performance, more than any of the others, still holds up to this day. Some of the other performances look a bit stagey, but not Hendry's. We must realize that was 1972, 50 years ago, half a century ago, but it could be now. I always think that's one of the hallmarks of great acting, that it doesn't look dated. And another irony of The Lotus Eaters was Hendry playing an alcoholic when you consider his problems off screen. By the early 1970s, Ian's private life was starting to unravel. He and Munro divorced, and tragically she died from a rare heart condition in 1972. Hendry was behind with his tax, and his much-touted breakthrough into world stardom hadn't happened. But this put Hendry in a strange situation. He was palpably a great screen actor. Tony Klinger, son of Get Carter producer Michael Klinger, put it very well when he said that Ian's problem was not that he was a very fine actor, it was that he was a great one. But big stars didn't want to be overshadowed in films by a supporting player who was obviously more talented than them. And I have it on good authority, by the way, that some really big stars didn't want to work with him for that very reason. So by 1972, the year that Assassin was filmed, we have a jaded Hendry whose movie career had peaked, divorced twice, tax man chasing him. Filming on Assassin started in the late summer of that year, a few months before Janet Munro died. Sad to say that Assassin and the horror movie Theatre of Blood, which preceded it, were effectively Ian's last roles as a leading man in films. It was also the beginning of a tough time for the British economy and its film industry, and many actors, such as Hendry, found the 70s a difficult decade. After that, it was mainly TV work and relatively small supporting roles in films. Ian seemed to crop up in everything. In guest roles in The Sweeney, The Persuaders, Van der Valk, The Protectors, and The Return of the Saint. Of all these guest roles in TV, my favourite was as Dave Brooker in The Sweeney, an iconic East End villain. Few actors could have carried off the role of Dave Brooker so well, And I think this gives us an insight into Hendry's success as an actor. He was utterly classless. Assassin was actually written by Michael Sloan, who 13 years later would have a big TV hit with The Equalizer starring Edward Woodward. And Assassin is directed very stylistically by Peter Crane. The Crane-Sloan team also worked together on Hunted, also starring Edward Woodward. And we can see certain similarities between Hendry's Assassin and Robert McCall. The loneliness of the long-distance hitman in London in Assassin, and the solitary New York vigilante with a mysterious part in The Equalizer, both at the mercy of intelligence forces beyond their control. In Assassin, the assassin is unnamed, just like the girl and other characters at MI5. It all adds to the impersonal predicament. The film opens with Hendry flying into London Airport. He has another job to do, but he has reservations. This only adds when he meets the girl, also unnamed, played by Verna Harvey, and has a terse exchange with Control, played by Edward Judd. It's funny, but if Hendry looks rather jaded here, so do the others, and strangely, most of the actors featured here with Hendry had their careers cut short. Edward Judd drifted into character roles and seemed to disappear. Mike Pratt, playing another hitman, most famous from Randall and Hopkirk, deceased, looks haunted and ravaged, and sadly died a few years later, aged only 45. Verna Harvey retired from the profession at the end of the 1970s, and Ray Brooks, once a big star of the 60s, drifted into TV. Hendry doesn't have a lot of dialogue, and so much of the character comes from within, and as always, Hendry conveys it well. A certain sweaty, seedy self-loathing. The assassin perhaps past his physical prime, as indeed Hendry was at 41 here. His voice is brandy-soaked and he looks older than his years. He's also heavily balding. Nothing strange in that nowadays when actors like Jason Statham have more stubble than hair, but perhaps unusual for the time and revealing for Hendry's total lack of vanity. And perhaps ultimately, he lacked that determined direction of travel that makes for international stardom. We're in the London of August 1972, and that's fun to revisit. When everyone still smoked in pubs, trains, and even on aircraft, when green shield stamps were all the rage, when the troubles in Northern Ireland were flaring up just like the trousers, when a martini would cost you a few pence, when Shaft's big score is advertised on hoardings, when Sean Connery was just about to come to his end as Bond, when The Godfather was about to come out, when hideous orange flowery wallpaper decorated homes, and when sideburns and long hair were seemingly obligatory, and when the UK was outside the common market, as it was then called. Second assistant director Martin Chilmaid told me some funny stories about Ian in this movie. He found him very amiable, very personable with fans, no airs and graces, but yes, rather volatile on occasions. One time, waiting to be called to the set and increasingly exasperated, Hendry got up off a sofa in the hotel and kind of kicked his leg up at Chilmaid and sort of struck him on the chin. It was a half-pulled kick, not intended to hurt, but even so it reflected Ian's exasperation with how everything was going. A funny, sad incident came at the end of a pickup shot in January 1973. These are relatively minor shots filmed after the principal photography has ended. This, we must remember, was just a few weeks after Janet Munro's tragic death. This winter's day started with Ian attending the wedding of Martin Chilmaid at Marylebone Registry Office and subsequently being plied with champagne at a reception at the Cumberland Hotel from where the pickup shot was to be filmed. One long tracking shot called for Ian to walk down Oxford Street in the West End. It was the time of the January sales. Before the filming, Ian apparently charged into various stores, Chilmaid in hot pursuit. Ian then got distracted by a bus conductress on a double-decker bus. In those days, they had an open entrance exit at the back with a white pole to hang on to. A bus pulled up, and the Caribbean conductress grabbed the pole, leaned out, and said in a voice half the street could have heard, "I sees you, Ian Hendry." Ian lit up and clambered aboard the bus, away from the Cumberland towards Breton Street, chatted to the conductress, and then a couple of hundred meters on, Chilmaid managed to pull him off. Chilmaid took him back towards the start point and via walkie-talkie gave him his order for him to stroll down Oxford Street for the one-take tracking shot. Martin told me the weaving was a little too much. Ian Hendry experienced spells of unemployment in the last few years of his life. During lean spells, he had to say yes to everything, including some provincial theatre tours. He appeared in The Owl and the Pussycat and Otherwise Engaged, both of which enjoyed very long runs. But these were far cries from his days as a movie star, and they didn't pay that well. His last major role as a leading man was in the ATV lunchtime soap for Maddie with Love. Towards the end of the run, he was exhausted and in dispute with the producers. Word began to spread that he was no longer reliable. He was without work for 2 years between 1981 and 1983. All actors get used to ups and downs in their careers, but Ian perhaps had more ups and downs than most. No wonder that Hendry's autobiography, which never saw the light of day, was to be called Life is a Yo-Yo. Ian's last acting role in 1984 was in the Channel 4 soap opera Brookside. By then he was visibly ailing, suffering from a throat condition. Actor Malcolm Tierney, playing chief villain Tommy McArdle in the soap, recalled to me how he offered Ian some sympathy of a kind, but Ian dismissed it. Perhaps Ian realized he'd been, to some extent, the architect of his own downfall. In the almost 38 years since his death, new audiences have rediscovered his talents, first through video in UK Gold, and then retro movie groups on Facebook and the internet. And because Ian was primarily a television actor, it's likely future generations will become familiar with his work. A tragic life? Not entirely. A life cut short, perhaps. But no actor who left behind 35 films and nearly 500 TV appearances can be said to have wasted their life. However, there should have been more great film roles. Perhaps if Hendry had emulated his contemporaries like Harrison O'Toole and got off the hard stuff, then there would have been. So many people, perhaps unsurprisingly, recall meeting Hendry in pubs, and he always seemed friendly enough, often helping out other artists, not only actors, but musicians and painters. He lifted a room with his presence. When I was once interviewed on a radio station about Hendry, one guy emailed me to say that he'd been a courier in the 1970s and he was entrusted with bringing a script to Hendry's house. Most actors just took the script and said thanks and bye. This guy recalled that Ian asked him in, gave him a Guinness and a tip. Off screen, well, Ian loved traditional jazz and on a Sunday night could be found at old pubs such as the Gatehouse in Highgate in the company of friends such as Ronnie Fraser, Jimmy Villiers, Peter Jeffrey and Mary Dawn Porter. Certainly Ian had a lot of friends in the business and his funeral was attended by 150 mourners. Ian's agent described him as Britain's greatest actor, a perfectionist. Nowadays, many people, if they remember him at all, quite rightly think of movies I've already mentioned, such as Get Carter and The Hill. So why did I call my biography Send in the Clowns? Because although Ian came to be known as a heavy, he was originally a talented light comedian, excellent in Noel Coward plays, and nurtured a great love of the circus. While he was at the Central School of Speech Drama in the early 50s, he befriended Coco the Clown and acted as his secretary and on one occasion his stooge in one of Coco's appearances in a TV show. One time, Ian recalled, when Coco was declared bankrupt, queues of children formed with coins waiting outside his caravan. Ian adored Coco, learned so much from him, and even acted as a clown at circuses himself. If you watch Ian's This Is Your Life, recorded in 1978, you'll see he cracks up when Coco's widow walks on.
Poliakovs. Valentina, tell me, how did Ian make out as a clown?
Oh, he was with my husband, very big friend.
Sadly, some of Ian's early work, most of the first series of The Avengers, most of The Informer and The Adventures of Don Quick, and even some great TV plays have been lost. That's why it's so wonderful that Assassin has now been re-released and in such a high quality format. Assassin, until very recently, remained one film that few of Ian's fans had seen, or if they had seen it, it was all a long time ago. It's great that this has been redressed. It may be a half century ago, but it's well worth seeing again. Peter Crane recalled for me, even though it was at a difficult time in his life, it was a true privilege to work with Ian. Some great memories. And it would appear most people had happy memories of Ian Hendry, even though he battled more than his fair share of demons.
No trouble.